Let's pray. Father, you are the great, unchangeable I am. Be with us now. Teach us. Glorify yourself. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Mike and his family are enjoying a great time together in Dallas this week. We're going to continue in the series that Mike has started for us, however, this series on ordinary people who, because of extraordinary faith, God was able to use in just wonderful ways. This week, we're going to look at the life of Joseph. Now, Joseph's life occupies about a quarter of the 50 chapters in the book of Genesis. So, we're going to have to discipline ourselves and concentrate on just one specific area. And the area that I'd like to address this morning has to do with trials that are unfair to me. What do I do when life is unfair? And we're going to approach it in this way. The first thing we'll do is we'll look at the citation of Joseph's faith in Hebrews chapter 11, where he's listed among those great heroes of faith. Then we'll move to Joseph's life, and we'll just take a brief overview of what led Joseph to be such one of our heroes. We'll then go to the commentary on the Old Testament, that is, the New Testament, and see what Paul has to say about what Joseph learned. And finally, we'll close with some practical applications. So let's begin in Hebrews chapter 11. In Hebrews chapter 11, I'm going to read from verse 22. By faith, Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the exodus of the sons of Israel and gave orders concerning his bones. Now, with all that you know about the life of Joseph, why in the world did the author of Hebrews pick this particular event, actually the last words we have recorded out of Joseph's mouth, to say that this is what proves Joseph's faith? Well, to gain a little insight into that, let's actually turn to this episode that the author of Hebrews is writing about. Let's go to Genesis chapter 50. And Genesis chapter 50, the last chapter of the book of Genesis, I'm going to read the passage that the author of Hebrews is referring to, beginning in verse 24. And Joseph said to his brothers, "I am about to die, but God will surely take care of you and bring you up from this land to the land which he promised on oath to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob." Then Joseph made the sons of Israel swear, saying, "God will surely take care of you, and you shall carry my bones up from here." So Joseph died at the age of 110 years, and he was embalmed and placed in a coffin in Egypt. Linda frequently reminds me that a Hebrew mind, as it steps forward into the future, actually looks backwards. The future is an essential piece of faith. Joseph was taking a giant step of faith here, and what was it? Joseph looked back on his life, on all that God had done for him, and he said this: God is going to keep his promise to Abraham, so when I die, save my bones. Now, what's interesting about this is if we look in the first part of chapter 50 of Genesis, we have another death, the death of Joseph's father, Jacob. And notice that Jacob also wanted to be buried in the promised land, in Canaan. In fact, he says, I'm looking at the very end of chapter 49, in verse 30, he wants to be taken to the cave that is in the field of Machpelah. This is a cave that Abraham had purchased for the family. And so when Jacob dies, the Pharaoh of Egypt funds this giant trip for his entire family to go to Canaan and to marry to bury Jacob in the family plot. But what does Joseph say? Joseph says, when I look back on my life and I see all that God did for me, I know he's going to keep the promise to Abraham. So when I die, don't worry, just save my bones, because I know eventually you're going to be in Canaan and you can take them then. What an act of faith for such an important moment in someone's life. What is it that Joseph saw when he looked back? What were the memorials that he saw that convinced him that God would be faithful? Let's take a brief overview of Joseph's life that brings us up to this decisive point in Genesis chapter 50. I'm going to start back in Genesis chapter 37. Genesis chapter 37, we begin to see the pieces that come together that lead to the event that changed the rest of Joseph's life, his betrayal by his brothers. And what we see from the onset is that, as you might expect, and as we know, Joseph was born into a pretty dysfunctional family, headed by a pretty dysfunctional individual. Jacob had spent his entire life trying to trick people into having his way. And here, he makes one more mistake. We read in verse 3 of chapter 37, "Now Israel," that is Jacob, "loved Joseph more than all his sons, because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a varied colored tunic." The first part of that verse is okay. If someone has 12 sons, you might expect that one or two might rise to the top of his favor. And in this case, one in particular, Joseph, did so. So yes, Joseph was his favorite son, but it's the way that Jacob chose to show him favor that I think was an issue. Notice that Jacob decided not to go out and make 12 nice jackets for all his sons. He decides to make one super jacket for Joseph. Don't you know the other brothers were happy with that? Joseph himself was not completely innocent in the events that led up to this betrayal by his brothers. The first thing we see about Joseph is that he is a youth at this point. We read that he's around 17 years of age. And what do we see, for example, in the beginning there? We read in verse 2 how he brought a bad report about his brothers back to his father. How come he didn't perhaps just talk to his brothers and try to handle this among themselves? The second thing we see about Joseph is that God, throughout his life, blessed him with this special ability to interpret dreams. And what we read as we read on in chapter 37 is that Joseph had two dreams in particular. In one dream, all of his brothers are bowing down to him. In the second dream, it's not only his brothers, but it's also his father and mother who are showing homage to him. So what does he do? He tells everyone about it. "Isn't this great? You guys are all going to bow down to me." Whereas he could have perhaps consulted with Jacob, "What do I do with this, father?" No, in his naivete of youth, Joseph decides to tell everyone. To me, though, perhaps Joseph's biggest mistake comes right at the end of verse 4. In verse 4 of chapter 37, we read that when the brothers saw how Jacob treated Joseph, they hated him and could not speak to him on friendly terms. Now, if you had 11 brothers and none of them could say a kind word to you, you might gather from their attitude that perhaps you had said something to offend them. But Joseph appears not to get the point. And then we come to that fateful day. Jacob and his family lived at this time in Hebron. Hebron is in the south of Israel. It's down about opposite the middle of the Dead Sea. We read, however, that Joseph's brothers were up tending the family flocks in Shechem. Now, you might recall from several chapters earlier that this is the first time we've not heard about Shechem. It was in the city of Shechem that the son of the ruler of Shechem, whose name was also Shechem, attacked Jacob's daughter, Dinah, Joseph's sister, and recalled the revenge that Joseph's brothers took on the city of Shechem. So here is Jacob sitting there, and he begins to think, what have I done? I've moved all my flocks and everything up to Shechem. I've got these brothers up there who already have a bad reputation in this city watching the flocks. No telling what's going to happen. I'd better check up on this. And he sends Joseph. And so now Joseph goes to Shechem. The brothers have already moved on a ways, but he finally catches up with them. And we get this picture in verse 19 of chapter 37. The brothers all out tending the flocks. Here comes Joseph in his super non-shepherd-like jacket. Here comes the dreamer. And what do? Their anger is such that they plot to kill him. Now, did Joseph make some mistakes? Yes, he did. But the mistakes he made were not something, I think, that should merit his death. And were it not for the intervention of the eldest son, Reuben, Joseph would have died at that point. Instead, however, he is sold to a group of Midianite traders who then sell him to a man named Potiphar. We're now in the beginning of chapter 19, who was the captain of the bodyguard of Pharaoh. So in an instant, Joseph goes from being his father's favorite to being a slave in a foreign country. God is with Joseph, however. And although his fortunes have fallen quite a bit, because of the presence of God, Joseph is able to prosper even in this difficult situation. In his book on the life of Joseph, Gene Getz does an interesting thing. He takes the next two pieces of Joseph's roller coaster life and places them side by side. And with verses from Scripture, we can see the identical thing happening in both cases. Whether we speak of Joseph's service in the house of Potiphar, or after the accusation by Potiphar's wife, if we speak of his time in prison, we see the same thing. Scripture tells us the Lord was with Joseph, the Lord blessed Joseph. Joseph's boss put him in control of everything he had. Everything that Joseph put his hand to, he prospered at. It's kind of spread out in the story of Potiphar, but let's read it with regard to his imprisonment. If you'll just turn over to the end of chapter 39, I'm reading in verse 21. The Lord was with Joseph and extended kindness to him, and gave him favor in the sight of the chief jailer. And the chief jailer committed to Joseph's charge all the prisoners who were in the jail, so that whatever was done there, he was responsible for it. The chief jailer did not supervise anything under Joseph's charge, because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made to prosper. This reached the point that things begin to come together, and we begin to see just a glimpse of what God has in store for Joseph's life. You might ask yourself, for example, why didn't Potiphar kill Joseph when he received this charge from his wife that Joseph, the false charge, that Joseph had tried to attack her? Well, if you look on down in chapter 40 and verse 4, we find that once Joseph goes to prison, he is put in charge of two new inmates that come in, the cupbearer of Pharaoh and Pharaoh's baker. And notice in verse 4 it says, the captain of the bodyguard put Joseph in charge of them. Who was the captain of the bodyguard? Potiphar. It just leads you to believe that perhaps Potiphar didn't believe the story that his wife had told and knew from his own experiences with Joseph the upright person that he was. And so twice, in Potiphar's house and in prison, we see God favor Joseph. But Joseph has to live life in the world. And the world is not interested in Joseph's success. If we back up now, the first thing we see with regard to his time with Potiphar is Scripture also tells us that on sort of a Brad Pitt scale, Joseph was a 10. Okay? He not only had leadership capabilities, but it says, Scripture says, he was well built and handsome. And this attracted Potiphar's wife and led to his first troubles. The second thing we see is that then when he finds himself in what my translation calls the dungeon, and these two other men are brought in, once again God favors him. He gives the cupbearer a good interpretation of a dream that the cupbearer had had. He gives the Pharaoh's baker bad news about the dream that the baker had had. But Joseph asks the cupbearer to remember him to Pharaoh. And does the cupbearer remember him to Pharaoh? Yes, he does. 2 years later. Joseph, we read in the next chapter, by the time he stands in the presence of Pharaoh, is 30 years old. We last saw him when he was 17. For the last 13 years, he has either been a slave or in prison or in agony these last 2 years, waiting for a promise to be fulfilled. And then everything coalesces. Then we see Pharaoh have a dream. The cupbearer remembers Joseph to Pharaoh. Joseph is brought into the presence of the king. He correctly interprets Pharaoh's dream. Joseph goes from being so bad, if you look at verse 14 of chapter 41, Joseph had to be cleaned up before he could even appear in the presence of Pharaoh. But once he comes into Pharaoh's presence, he's elevated from prisoner to the second highest position in Egypt, only second to Pharaoh himself. He leads Egypt through 7 years of plenty. Then he leads Egypt through the 7 years he had predicted of drought. This drought brings his brothers from Canaan because the drought has extended that far, and so it brings them to buy grain. There is a reconciliation, and Joseph does not return to Canaan. Rather, the germ of what is to be the nation Israel, according to God's plan, is brought to Egypt. How did Joseph survive this? Those years waiting for the cupbearer to fulfill his promise. Those years in prison, falsely accused by Potiphar's wife. What was going through his mind that allowed him to survive that time? What should go through my mind when I face a trial in my life? For that, we need to go to our commentary on the Old Testament, and that's the New Testament. So if you will, turn with me to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, Paul speaks to this very issue. Now he begins in verse 17 of chapter 8 with a wonderful promise that you and I are fellow heirs with Christ. But notice that Paul does not stop the verse there. If indeed we suffer with him in order that we may be glorified with him. Suffering is an expected and natural part of the Christian life. That's not the problem. The problem is how we handle it. And Paul gives us in the next verses three keys to making life through trials. Key number one is found in the very next verse. In verse 18, Paul says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us." When he writes to the Corinthians, Paul talks about a weight of glory that is placed on us and compares it to minor temporary issues that we have to put up with in this life. The second help that we have in times of distress is in verse 26. We already know that you and I have a defender before the very throne of God. In his first epistle, John writes in chapter 2 and verse 1, "And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous." But not only do we have an intercessor before the throne of God, we have individually an intercessor in our hearts, and that is God the Holy Spirit. And then the third thing that Paul gives us to get us through these tough times is that wonderful verse, verse 28. "And we know," there is no doubt, "and we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose." All things are going to work together for good, but there is a requirement. This does not apply to everyone in the world. It applies to those who love God. Now, what does it mean here to love God? I think it means this. I think it is not referring to me loving God because of what He has done for me. Because in this particular verse, if that's why I love God, then I end up in this catch-22, where God is causing things to work for my good if I love Him, and I love Him because He caused good things to happen. I think what Paul means here is something deeper. I think what Paul means when he speaks of those who love God is he speaks of those who love God for whom He is. He is our God. We're studying the Old Testament in the life of Joseph, so let's consider an Old Testament passage. In Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 4, we have one of the key statements of belief throughout the biblical history of Israel. Verse 4 is called the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. That's all that Israel is told about God. He is our God, He is one. And what is Israel supposed to do with it? How are they supposed to respond? The very next verse, verse 5, is the great commandment. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. This passage, Romans 8:28, applies to those who love God for whom He is. What about those times when my love isn't quite that strong? Notice that you and I are given a dual description. We are those who love God, that's our part. And we are those who are called according to His purpose. And we can stand on the assurance that it is not our frailty that keeps us within God's blessing. It is His sovereign choice. We are called according to His purpose. And if that is true, then what Paul says is that God causes all things to be good? No. He causes the good and the bad. He causes all things to work together for good. And this is that great insight that Joseph had. How do I know that? Let's go back to the book of Genesis. Let's go to Genesis chapter 50 once more. Near the end of Joseph's life, Jacob has died. Joseph's brothers begin to think, oh no. Dad is dead. Joseph's in charge. What is he going to do to us? And what is Joseph's answer to them? Look at verse 19. Do not be afraid. Why? Look at verse 20. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring about this present result to preserve many people. You meant it for evil. God, in His sovereignty, used it for good. And this is not the first time that Joseph has this revelation. Earlier, in chapter 45 of Genesis, his brothers also have this same nervousness, this same pang of guilt for what they did to him. And notice what he says to them in chapter 45 and verse 5. Do not be grieved or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. And again in verse 7, and God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant in the earth. Joseph got it. All things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. But now, church is going to be over in just a minute. We're all going to have to go home and immerse ourselves in whatever our current trials are. If I'm in the midst of a trial right now, what attitude should I adopt? What can I learn from what Joseph learned that will help me get through those unfair events in life? The first one, I think, is this. I need to adopt the mind of God. I need to adopt God's strategy and not concern myself so much with myself. What did Joseph say both in Genesis chapter 45 and in Genesis chapter 50. God sent me. I'm here because of God. But why? For a bigger purpose. I'm here because of the nation Israel. I'm part of God's plan. And I think one thing that will get us through trials is if we recognize that we are part of something bigger than ourselves. We're part of God's plan. And what looks like something bad at the moment, I know is going to work out for the good. The second thing is this. If you will, turn to chapter 40, 41, where Joseph first enters the presence of Pharaoh. I need to remember at all times that I am a witness for Christ Jesus, and my behavior during a trial reflects on him. Joseph, we saw in verse 14, had to be cleaned up before he could come into Pharaoh's presence, but Pharaoh is eager to see him. Why? Because Pharaoh has a dream. And look at the very end of verse 15. I know, Pharaoh says, when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. And what is Joseph's immediate response? It is not in me. God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer. There will be a time in every trial that every one of us faces when we need to be sensitive to the fact that we are being called upon to witness to others. Linda and I have a friend who 2 or 3 weeks ago went into the hospital. He thought he had some minor problem with his heart. It turned out he had leukemia. His attitude, the open conversation about God in his hotel room, has turned that one little spot into a magnet in that wing of the hospital. We will be called upon to witness in the midst of trial. The third thing I think is this. Do. We don't just sit in the dungeon. Every individual in this room has been given a spiritual gift by God. And in, for example, in the case of Joseph with his interpretation of dreams, you may have some special talent. We need to keep about being what God would have us be. We need to keep our Christian life running even in the midst of trial. We should do everything except one thing. And that is, we should not take revenge on those who put us in that situation. Once again, for commentary on that, I'm turning to the words of Paul. Romans chapter 12, Paul tells us in verse 17, never pay back evil to evil for evil to anyone. Verse 19, never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Verse 21, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. There's one final thing that I need to do, and it may be the hardest thing of all. And that's those 13 years. Now, just like there are dog years, there are also fill-in-trial years. A year to fill when he's in trial is about 24 hours. And then I think I've had just enough of it. When is God going to solve this problem? 13 years Joseph went without seeing his family. Most of that in prison. And the last 2 years must have been particularly egregious, waiting for the cupbearer to return the favor that Joseph had given him. I wait. I wait for God. And in the meantime, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Let's pray. Father, when we're in trial, it's just like when we're sick. No one is as sick as me. No one has the trials that I have. Lord, give us the bigger picture. Show us that we are part of something bigger than ourselves, and align us with your plan. Father, we pray that you make us, as we go through trials, sensitive to opportunities to witness for you. And may all that we do glorify your name. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. You guys have a great week. See you next week.
Most of the time we simply have